Good evening. Thanks for staying up and welcome along to Footy SA and WA. It's all thanks to OTR who are making life easy. Huge show coming your way. Blighty's back with another Premiership hero. We get on AFL Hall of Famer Glenn Jakovich. Really looking forward to doing that. And a really tough SA and WA face-off between two Brownlow medalists. Scotty Wattis is here as always. Scotty, good evening.
We are on a hiding to nothing. And how do you split Fife and Ricciuto? We're going to work that out, but very, very tough. Very tough call.
We're going to be unpopular, I think, with half. Some in SA and some in WA. Let's get straight into the Dometic news headlines. There's no shortage of those. Dometic mobile living made easy. There may not be any footy, but still a lot of talking points. And it started with Port Adelaide chairman David Koch when he went on ABC Radio on Sunday. And he was asked about his coach Ken Hinckley's future beyond this year.
As far as I'm concerned, Ken will be coaching next year because we're incredibly confident of the team that we've got now going forward. We have performance triggers in virtually all our contracts with people who work for us because we're a performance organisation. Because there's that trigger there doesn't mean it will be triggered at all.
So just to clear this up, he's contracted until the end of 2021. Yep. To guarantee that contract, they need to make finals this year. Now, it's all been thrown into absolute carnage and chaos. I think that is the right sentiment coming from the footy club because you can imagine running a coaching process when we don't even know when the season is going to finish. So for certainty of the footy club, for the players, for the staff, I think it's the right call to guarantee Ken that year next year and then let's judge. What say you?
I 100% agree. I think stability is the key word at the moment. And there is just, it's hard to see a set of circumstances where a coach is going to lose their job at the end of this year because this is just a year out of the box, as we know. So 6 weeks into next year or 10 weeks into next year, it could be a possibility, but there won't be any changes at the end of this year.
Stuart Drew, the Gold Coast coach, said during the week that there'll be an asterisk next to the Premiership winner, but not for the reason that we thought. He thinks this year will be harder to win than ever. And if you do win it, it's almost cause for extra celebration. I don't necessarily agree with that because who knows, the grand final, no crowds, grand final parade, no crowds. It's not going to be as special for the players, but it's still going to be tough to win. Would you celebrate it like a normal one?
If you got one and it's in your hand,
you, take it.
You celebrate it, no doubt. And it will. I think it'll be tougher in some ways. I mean, the preparation is uncharted waters at the moment. So preparing a team to be ready to go whenever that might be, that's a nightmare for the sports conditioning staff at any club. So a lot of different scenarios and the team and the club that adapts quickest and best, they could end up with a premiership.
I had a good debate on Footy Classified tonight about Damien Hardwick. He likes what the NRL did by setting a date. He wants Gillon McLachlan from the AFL to do the same. Now, Gill's held off until May the 11th after the National Cabinet meets on May the 10th for more certainty. Yep. I support the NRL. I reckon if they can get a jump, more eyeballs on the screens for a month across the world of them playing their sport while we're sitting back and waiting. Or do you think Gill's done the right thing and been responsible with his decision-making?
Oh, I think he has. And that's typical of a coach, though, in Damien. You want to know when the dates are and I want to be working towards a goal. But I think the AFL have been quite measured in the way that they've very carefully planned their way through this. Gill's not going to jump at anything quickly. I don't mind a little bit of patience. That still doesn't mean they can't get rolling quicker, but they're just holding off their decision at the moment. I think it's good leadership by Gill.
Only one game's been played this year, but I reckon there's some players across the competition really looking to shore up their future. We know the AFL aren't ticking off on any contracts for out-of-contract players at the moment until there's some more certainty around. So I think there's going to be some players looking around. And I want to take a look at two important players for West Coast and one from Adelaide tonight. Start with Josh Kennedy. Turns 33 in August this year. He's out of contract. Is there a club, say a Collingwood, in the competition that may come and offer him a two-year deal? They need a forward, particularly if Dugowie leaves and he's ageing and West Coast can trade him now and he gets some security. Could you see something like that happening?
You could. I think he's got currency for the next 2 years. If I'm West Coast at the moment, I don't think they can win a premiership in the next 2 years without him being in that forward line. Darling is not ready to shoulder the responsibility of being the number one top dog in that forward line. Even though he's a, look, his performances are dropping slightly. There's no doubt about that. But he has a key role to play in 2 years. But if you are a Collingwood, if you could pinch him for 2 years, that could be the missing ingredient for them too. So his stocks actually rise at the moment. I think his manager would be very happy with where he sits.
Yeah, particularly if list sizes reduce and clubs become more ruthless, there's going to be some opportunities for some players to change clubs and it's going to be busy.
Are you worried about him at 33?
Well, I've got so much respect for him. I think because he's done a pre-season and he's had this break, I think that'll serve him well. I think he's still got at least two good years left in him, at a stretch three, but I reckon there's a club that would be willing to take a risk on him, and that club may be a Collingwood, someone in the window looking for a big power forward. The other one's Brad Crouch. We know he shopped himself around at the end of last year. He's a free agent, meaning a club can get him for nothing. And Adelaide are in the situation where they're probably not going to challenge in his prime. So he's 26 years of age. Crow's not going to be around the mark for, you'd think, 4 to 5 years. Are they better moving him on, getting an elite draft pick for him and continuing the rebuild, and see Brad joining a club that needs a midfielder like a Carlton or a North Melbourne or a St Kilda?
It's just sometimes where you are at a certain time, and that, I guess, development of a list is so important. And I think you're right. You can't see them being in the premiership hunt this year in particular, regardless of how many games unfold. So I think he's on shaky ground at the moment, and that sort of player that's not, he's not as pivotal as a Kennedy to their structure. I think that makes him a little bit vulnerable.
Coaches all across the competition have been asked about footy hubs, which we think are going to be the key to getting footy back. Justin Longmuir from Fremantle, the rookie coach, was asked, and he spoke about this on SEN Breakfast.
The Victorian thing makes a lot of sense, given that, you know, there's 9 or 10 teams really from that region. So, and the resources that are in Victoria for footy are greater than probably any other state. So if you're going to house all 18 clubs, that would be the place to do it.
So that's one view. The other view is coming from the players. And captain of the Adelaide Crows, Rory Sloane, was quite outspoken, and he relayed his concerns about the footy hubs.
So I've got a young family. We're here, Belinda and I, in Adelaide. We don't have any family in Adelaide. So to pack up and leave her one out for 6 to 8 weeks would be incredibly tough. I mean, I'd certainly look at taking them both with me, depending on where the hub was at. If that meant going to up north or back to Victoria, we'd certainly look at something like that. But I suppose one of the parts I struggle with as well is, and this again is just from a position that I'm in, is who says my job's more important than her job and me to ask her to pack up and come with me all for the sake of my jobs.
Your thoughts?
Oh, I'm against this being a hub set up solely in Victoria. I think this is a national competition. I think hubs should be spread between the three powerful football states, South Australia, Western Australia and Victoria. Share the load, share the responsibility, and actually provide a little bit of catalyst for all of those communities. So, and if I win a premiership and I've had the luxury of living in my home environment for the whole season as a Victorian, that is a tainted premiership for me. Spread the load, support the economy in three different states, but it's time we actually made this more of a national competition. This is not the VFL. We need to move on from that.
Well said. I think I agree with that one. Big show coming up. Joining us next is an AFL Hall of Famer. He's a great character, and he's going to talk about one of the biggest games that he played very, very early on in his career. Glenn Jakovic joining us on Footy SA and Footy WA next. Watching Footy SA and WA, thanks to OTR, making life easy. And it's time for a Kia Great State moment, brought to you by our great friends at Kia. Their 7-year warranty, Kia offers value that you can trust at Australia's best 7-year warranty across the entire Kia range. Scotty, going to go back to a game that you played in.
Yeah, 1991, and we thought we'd go to one of the legends of the game in Glenn Jakovic. Jacko started playing state footy at 16. I know this game meant a lot to him because a year before, the Vics touched us up. And there was a score to settle, wasn't there, Jacko?
G'day, Scotty and Kane. It certainly was. It was, I guess, at the very back end of what State of Origin was so big in WA, South Australia and Victoria. And it was a Tuesday night, 1990. The Vics came over and had a star-studded lineup with Ablett, Burden, the Flea Waitman, they had Mickey McGuan in the middle, Tony Shaw yapping as he would on a Tuesday night. And they really give it to us by about 80-odd points. And the following year, I guess it started to change a little bit. Mick Mouldhouse was coach at WA. He took over from Ron Alexander, and it was the first time we had a Victorian coach to coach a State of Origin side of a different origin. So that was quite ironic in itself. It was a Tuesday night again. I think Mark Bairstow came across and played. He had a fantastic night. He was in the peak of his career. Chris Mainwaring was the captain. But what was ironic, Scotty, as you know, the whack of it was obviously a cricket oval. It pelted down with rain from the moment you rocked up right to the final siren. And WA ended up having 32 shots on goal. I think we 19-13 and 127, a 7-9-51. Not that we're keeping score, but as you can see, the footage there in the background of the crowd, umbrellas everywhere. It just pelted down with rain. And Summer kicked six. Toby Bairstow, who was probably one of the best midfielders going around at the time in the AFL, he kicked four from the middle, and we had 12 goal scorers that night, including, I think, yourself, Scotty. I think you got amongst the score sheet as well. That was your offensive running during the course of the night. I don't think we saw you in the back line that night, Scotty, but Peter Matera was playing. You had Nicky Wimmer, Darren Buick, one half court flank, and Summer. I mean, he was playing on Langford. You had Silvani out there as well. He was certainly in the prime of his career. That was a year Summer kicked 111 goals. So he was certainly in the height of his career.
Jacko, the year before, as a great summary that you just gave us, the year before, Teddy Whitten had a lot to say after the game. Stick it up him, he said. He was a little bit quieter after this game in 91, wasn't he?
Well, he certainly... he set the barometer. There was no doubting that. The State of Origin was massive. It was a Tuesday night. They give us a good old pacing, the Bix. And he was the man that led the charge. He was the first one out on the oval. And, you know, the Channel 7 boundary rider was following him. And he said, "You got a comment?" He says, "Yeah, I do." We stuck it right up him. And then 12 months later, the same boundary rider was chasing the great man. And he was lost for words. There was nothing he could say. And the legend grew from there. It was a great rivalry. And we know what that part of football was so big for a lot of people back in the heyday.
So you're so passionate about state footy, Jacko. Like, I never got to really experience it, but got to watch it as a kid. And my old man coached South Australia and loved it. Is there ever a day that it could come back? And with the uncertainty at the moment, could they restructure it in the schedule to bring another source of revenue into the game?
They can, and they probably won't. But they've missed a generation because a lot of these young guys that I come across through our football industry, they say, probably they're not passionate about it. Whereas someone asked myself and Scott in our time, we didn't flinch, we'd say we'd be on it. From a week to week, we played in a particular club jumper. Then when you got the opportunity to play state footy and someone handed you a state jumper at training, it somewhat elevated the prestige of playing the highest level. That doesn't exist anymore, which is unfortunate. And we hope that now through what we're going through from a national point of view with this COVID-19, football's been starved of every state now. They're not watching footy and they're looking at possible hubs. They're looking at possible alternatives and ideas. And can state footy come through this period now to showcase it and see if it can work? And I'm certainly all for it because I know what it meant for a lot of us growing up. That Tuesday afternoon or a Tuesday night to leave work or leave school and go to Subi Oval or the Wacker, that was the pinnacle of the year. We love watching the Waffle Grand Final, the Waffle Final Series, as well as the VFL Final Series and the Grand Final of the MCG. They were iconic moments of the year. But so was that Tuesday night in July to watch a State of Origin game. That was massive. And if we could bring that back somehow, we're much richer for it as a football nation.
Jacko, I think you're right. And again, I think when you look at your career, the opportunities to play State of Origin footy with amazing players. Like you got to play with Nicky Winmar and Mark Bairstow. And then you got to play against the best that the nation had to offer. That's a massive highlight. I think it's a shame, Jacko, that, you know, it doesn't exist anymore. I think there is still an appetite for it, but it has to be player-driven. If it's not player-driven, it'll never get off the ground. But there was no holds barred when we played state footy. No. There was no looking after yourself for injuries.
Jacko, I can't let you go without showing some vision of Scotty Waters. Now, he tells me he had an interesting haircut. So let's roll the vision of a young Scotty Waters sitting on the bench with... Who's that bloke in the middle there? Carl Langdon. Was he as much of a clown as he was back then as he is now?
Well, the peroxide, he used to go on a Thursday, old Boris, and he used to go, Morris Mead was the choice of hairdresser here in Perth. And he used to get a dye every Thursday, and we thought that some of that peroxide seeped into his brain a little bit. And that first 30 minutes, God help you if the opposition playing on a half-forward, playing half-back flank on Carl Langdon. He was going to certainly let you know about it, but he was a great warrior, Carl, and Scotty, I think he was a visitor a few times to Morris Mead. Dude.
I needed a
couple of firms here,
Scotty. I should have been visiting more often when I have a look at that. I'd love some of that hair back now.
Outstanding memories, Jacko. Thanks for reliving them with us here tonight.
Thanks, boys.
Glenn Jakovich, what an absolute legend he was, and one of the all-time greats.
He is the sort of player or person now that could actually be a champion to bring state footy back. He was so passionate about it. He played at 16. It was an honour. We need those sorts of champions to stand up and demand that it's back on the calendar.
Another man who loved his state footy was our next man, Amy's Blighty, SA Premiership Heroes. It is back, insuring Australians for 50 years. Lucky you're with Amy. Who is Blighty's next Premiership Hero?
Rick Davies, commonly known as the Jumbo Prince. Sturt have had a lot of great players in their sandful. Rick is right up there with the best of them. Would you believe a seven-time Best and Fairest winner and dual premiership player in 1974 and 1976? And I still hear people talk about his game in the 1976 Grand Final.
Side, looking for Russell, even brilliantly intercepted by Davies. The opportunity, but it's Davies in front once again.
Gets up towards a pass, Davies there on his own.
All-Australian, a Ken Farmer medalist, kicked 151 goals, which is the record, and also a Hall of Fame. And I was there on his induction night. It was one of the greatest inductions of all times. The Jumbo Prince was exactly that. A ball of glass with a lot of funny stories, a terrific character within the game, but more importantly, a premiership hero and a great player.
Thanks for joining us on Footy SA and WA. It's all thanks to our OTR Barista Made C Coffee. OTR takeaway this week. Go ahead and treat yourself at OTR to a delicious snack or a Barista Made C Coffee. Magnificent in there. Get in there for your takeaway. They do the best coffee at OTR. This is a tough one. We've been doing the SA and WA face-off, Scotty, and this is an absolute ripper. Nat Fyfe and Mark Rusciutto, when it is all said and done, who is going to have the better career, or who would you take?
Oh, this is extremely tough. Look, I'm going to make a case for Rusciutto. Look, I think his kicking skills were just a level above Nat Fyfe's, and his consistency, 12 years in a row, he played 20 games plus, so he was Mr. Consistent, and averaged a goal a game. So just, I think the other big difference here is the All-Australians, 8 compared to 3. Fyfe's still got a bit of petrol left in the tank. But if I'm going to make an argument, that's my argument for Rusciutto.
Well, and it's a pretty good one. Here's some of the highlights of Rusciutto. Just such a powerful force, wasn't he, through the midfield and forward. But I'm going to go with Nat Fyfe. I just think more powerful around the footy. Wins a bit more of the ball than what Mark Rusciutto did. And when you look at the two Brownlow medals, a better winning record, yes, he doesn't have the premiership, which counts against him. But who's a better player when they're fully up and running? I'm going to say Fyfe is more impactful and more powerful around the footy. But... it's not going to be a right or wrong answer, is it?
No, and look, to counteract my own argument here, Fyfe, this was one amazing stat that I did find on him. In 162 qualifying games, he's been best on ground 41 times.
You're kidding.
Every four games, he's best on ground.
As voted by the umps.
As voted by the umpires. That's unheard of.
he might win another Brownlow medal, Nat Fyfe. If you're looking at this season, the way it's set up, if he's fit off those numbers, he plays, he poles. So, I mean, it's going to be a shortened season. It's going to be, it's going to suit him in terms of 16-minute quarters because that'll suit the style of play that he plays. He could easily win another Brownlow medal before he's done.
There's only four that have won three in their career, and you could absolutely see him doing that in a short season because he does have some injury concerns. You know, a 15 to 18 game season would absolutely suit him up.
Pavlich's clearly number one at Fremantle. Is Fyfe coming?
It's getting closer, there's no doubt. Pavlich, over the length of a career, playing the hardest position on the ground, still has him at the moment, but he puts one more Brownlow in the back pocket, it's going to be hard to make an argument against him.
And if he gets a premiership, then he probably will go past Pav, even though Pav played so many games. Right, that was tough. You can get involved on the socials as well, Footy SA and Footy WA, to have your vote. Stick around, still plenty more to come in the show tonight. Thanks for staying up late for us. You are watching Footy SA and WA, all thanks to OTR, who are making life easy. And just in the ad break, check Twitter, Scotty. It's blowing up over Rusciuto and Fyfe.
In any case for Rusciuto over Fyfe, or has Fyfe got him covered?
Genuinely 50-50, I think, at the moment.
I tried to make a case for Roo.
It is early days. Time now to have a look at this, though. It is our Lumo Energy SA list, powered by Lumo Energy SA. They are 100% Australian-owned and 1,000% about you. They've also been powering me through self-isolation. This is the coaches and TikTok. You know what TikTok is?
I know what it is.
Yeah.
These coaches are butchering it.
Bucks was okay, I thought.
Yeah. Good moves. He's actually dancing better than his young boy there. He's put a bit of time into that, Bucks.
Goody was good too. Now, this is the one that's been going viral. Goody very, I don't know how many takes it took him, but him and his two kids looking very, very at home with the dance moves there.
And the finish. Nice. I like the finish. What about Horsehair? Blindfolded from the line, making it look as easy as you like. That's one. That's two. There's three.
Not even touching the rim.
That is unbelievable skill. He was a great goal kicker in his day too.
And this is Dimmer. This is the premiership coach, been absolutely stitched up. I don't know how, but someone's put the Snapchat filter on him. And this is the boys. This is what we love, bit of creativity. The Hill brothers too. Sonny Walters, who goes back and does what he did so well last year, and that is finish to ice the game against Port Adelaide.
Nice seeing him cut those clips together. Gee, we'd like to be seeing that,
wouldn't you?
In the real time stuff.
You worried about Stephen? Stephen Hill.
He's concerned about him.
Can't get right.
Well, he's had recurring injuries now for a number of years, so it's a big challenge for him.
Talk about it next week. Have a great night, everyone.